Thank you for joining Auto Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and we will take you inside the auto industry like never before. And when I say we, I mean me and my very, very knowledgeable and good-looking full panelists, full panel located in the film strip below. If you've been watching us on a regular basis, you probably see an unfamiliar face down there and give you, you know, to be honest with you, I don't know who the heck it is either, but I guess we'll find out a little later. But like we normally do, I'll have the journalists introduce themselves, talk a little bit about who they are and where they are, and let's get it rolling. Valerie.
Hi, everyone. Hi, Roosevelt. Happy to be back. I've missed you all. I'm coming to you from Austin, Texas, where the sun is coming out today. We had some rain this week, which is always welcome. I am representing Latino Traffic Report, which is a blog that I launched last year, focusing on the multi-generational Latino and trying to inform them about the auto industry and the automotive vehicles that I get to drive every week, and hoping to help them make good choices as auto buyers, and looking forward to our conversation.
Great. Russ.
Hi, coming to you live from Greenville, South Carolina. I'm Russ Heaps. Excuse me, I got so excited I got a tickle in my throat. I've been covering the automotive industry for about 30 years. I've done it for newspapers, magazines, and now some dot-coms like AutoTrader and Bankrate. I also run a little website called Greenville Insider, a deeper dive into Greenville, South Carolina.
Ron.
Hi, Ron Moorhead, coming to you from Northern California. I'm the editor of Auto Reviews Plus. I freelance for numerous magazines, newspaper syndications across the board. I have been in the industry since I left college, or they kicked me out of college, whatever you prefer. And this illustrious panel will inform you of what's going on in the auto industry. Glad to be here.
Great. Linda.
Good afternoon. I'm Linda Sharp, and I'm coming to you from the slightly overcast Blue Ridge Mountains of North Carolina. Like these other gentlemen, I've been in this business for 20-plus years. A recovering race car driver who fell into a computer and started typing. I've had a syndicated newspaper column on the Cox Wire and New York Times Wire Services, written for major newspapers around the country, magazines. I currently produce a blog, sharpdriver.com. I invite you to check it out for the latest car reviews, and there's also a section on my racing history and a little bit of NASCAR, a lot of Nissan Datsun racing, and I have motor oil in my veins. I can't cook, so here I am. These are my buddies, and I'm proud to be here, proud to be part of this group.
Great, Greg.
Good afternoon. I'm Greg Morrison. I'm owner and executive producer of Bumper to Bumper TV. We do weekly video reviews of cars and trends in the industry. I'm back in Atlanta in my subterranean office after a couple of weeks on the road. I've been covering the industry about 22, 23 years with everyone on this panel, and we all have war stories to tell and share, both about cars and our lives. Look forward to today's discussion.
Great. Frank.
Hey, it's Frank Washington. I'm based in Detroit. I do a syndicated column called AboutThatCar.com. I also have a website of the same name. I've been covering the industry for a few decades now. We're happy here. Weather is good here. We need some rain. But other than that, I'm looking forward to a great conversation today.
Great. And our newest panelist is Chris. Met Chris at the last week at What's New, Chrysler What's New, in Detroit. And Frank, I was looking for you, man. Everybody's looking for you, and you weren't there. You didn't post. What happened, man? What happened?
I had things to do.
Oh, my goodness. What could be more important than being with Russ and I?
Well, I could think of a couple of dozen things.
Well, I guess you did, didn't you? But anyway, I'm going to have Chris to introduce himself, talk a little bit about what he does, and more importantly, his business. And if you all have any quick questions for Chris, we'll pepper him. And Chris, welcome aboard.
Thank you. Again, I'm Chris Lawrence. I have a company called Auto Academics, and what we do is we help clients research, locate, and purchase vehicles. I'm based out of the Atlanta region, and I guess I'm the newbie here on this panel, not just on this video show, but just in the media sector itself. I guess about maybe 2.5 years ago, I started a media side of my company, and we do video reviews on YouTube. And so that's just Auto Academics. It's youtube.com/autoacademics. And like everybody else here, we're just trying to help people learn more about vehicles and to make wiser choices as they purchase those vehicles. I just want to thank everybody for inviting me in today.
Great.
I have a question for Chris.
Let me make a quick comment first, Russ, and then you can ask. Okay.
All right. I was
talking to Chris at the reception, as a matter of fact, at What's New, before we went over to the actual event. And Chris went through this long explanation as to what he did. So I said, oh, you're a broker. He went round and around. I help people buying cars. I said, oh, you stand between the buyer and the seller, right? He said, yes. I said, okay, you're a broker. Then he said, oh, no, no. He didn't want to own up to the fact, yeah, he's a broker. People pay him to find a car. So anyway, go ahead, Russ.
I have a new terminology. I'm an automotive consultant.
Yes. Broker. Broker.
Okay, this will be his last appearance on the show. We've brought him raining off.
Go ahead, Russ. It's always a revolving door down on the far end of the panel. Have you ever noticed that?
Yeah.
I wanted to give Chris the opportunity to pad his resume a little bit. Chris, aren't you the president of some automotive organization?
El Presidente.
I am. I'm also the I'm newly the president of the Greater Atlanta Automotive Media Association as well. Yes.
Now, how could you forget that? They should have led with that.
Well, they don't pay the bills yet.
That's okay. That's a biggie out there for people who are looking for contacts and people to come and review their cars.
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay. Yeah, we've been kidding Chris about where his Secret Service detail is.
Any more quick questions for Chris or any more comments, Chris?
How's that adorable baby in first grade now?
Oh, man. The baby is going into kindergarten. And then
oh, my goodness.
Going into third grade. Yep.
Yeah, you're going
like crazy.
You're going to have gray hairs like the rest of us soon. Don't worry about it.
Oh, they're coming. They just don't show up on camera as well yet.
All right, let's do a quick run through of what are you driving this week, Valerie.
Okay, I am driving, well, I just finished, let's say that. I just finished driving the Volkswagen Jetta 2.0T GLI. First off, I just want to the best part for me is that it was a 6-speed manual, and that's always so rare, and it's always a treat to be able to get a manual transmission on a vehicle and to get a manual transmission with a vehicle that is not stripped down, that actually has some extra features, and the Jetta had blind spot warning, leather seats, a sunroof. It had a few extra items on it. Its MSRP is about $30,000. So it was a really very enjoyable ride, and nice to have some options out there in the midsize segment.
So how was your trip to Spain?
Fabulous. Thanks for asking. Yes, I was able to join Volvo in Malaga, Spain, for the launch of the S90, 2017 S90, their big sedan. Interestingly, they're launching this sedan at a time that they said a lot of luxury leases are coming up. And that's really where they're hoping to pounce on these leases and lessees, let's say, and giving them an option in the full-size luxury sedan market. Of course, it will be powered by their four-cylinder, their turbocharged and supercharged engines, and the interior to me was really, of course, gorgeous with Scandinavian. What I noticed is a new design cue that you will see on every vehicle. I'm predicting this right now. On their wood accents, instead of this wood, very thin wood veneer that we can always tell is real wood, they've got this chunky wood accent that you're going to start to see, and I think it's really, really nice. So we had a great time. It's a beautiful vehicle. I think it will be very competitive. And, yeah, great, great times.
Great. Russ?
I just want to say first, Frank, that you were sorely missed last week at Fiat Chrysler, and mainly because I had to eat lunch with Roosevelt. Okay.
Well, the rest of us chopped liver, you didn't miss us.
Well, no, sushi. You know.
Sushi.
Sushi, yeah. In my book, it'd be sushi. Actually, this week I've got the Titan HD, the Nissan Titan HD pickup truck, but we kind of covered that ground a couple of weeks ago. So last week I had the 2017 Audi A4, and retails for about $54,000. Let me see here. It's got a 2-liter turbocharged engine, 252 horsepower, 273 pounds-feet of torque. For the 54 grand, it had basically all the bells and whistles on it, Bang Olufsen surround sound system, audio system, and all of the safety, adaptive cruise control, and all the safety items you can get on an Audi. And the fuel economy is 24 city, 31 highway, which I thought was pretty decent for a car that's got a lot of zip to it, and all-wheel drive as well, and 27 MPG in combined driving.
Whoa, Ron.
Hi there. Most of you all know that I come from truck country and horse country. So I just want you to know that we have the oldest continuous California rodeo coming up the 4th of July, which I happen to be a part of. But I have a GLC. Yeah, of course.
He's a clown.
The clown. I can't move that fast. I have a 2016 Sierra all-terrain, four-door, all-wheel drive SLT pickup truck. Perfect. These cowgirls and cowboys just love this stuff. $56,000, and it is just packed full of all kinds of features. One of the good things about Chevrolet and GMC and the V8s that they make, it has the cylinder deactivation. So if you're cruising down the road, it switches over to four-cylinder, right? 21 miles to the gallon on the highway. I'm averaging about 18 to 19, and you guys know I don't have a light foot on that little skinny pedal on the right-hand side, so pretty impressed with the fuel economies with a big truck.
Great. Linda?
Last week I had mentioned, or week before last, I had mentioned that I had just got the 2016 Ford Explorer, but I really hadn't had a chance to drive it. Well, since then I have spent a week with it, and I have to say, it is one of my favorite SUVs out there, and it's not a, quote, crossover. It's a real SUV. Today's Explorer is almost as big as what our 2002 Expedition is, but it's easy to drive. It's rear-wheel drive, which I'm a longtime fan of rear-wheel drive. They've done a really good job with the third-row seat. They flip and fold and become a flat floor, and there's all these little buttons that do it, so it's a piece of cake. There's no more yanking the seat out and trying to find some place to put it. It has an EcoBoost engine in it. We got about 23 miles per gallon on the highway, which was a little better than what the EPA rated it at, 22. Ours was a platinum edition, which is, I mean, it was pretty decked out. It was four-wheel drive. And it's just a really comfortable, easy-to-drive vehicle. And while it still has the Ford sync, it also had some knobs. I love knobs. It makes it easy to change the station. And yeah, great vehicle. Of course, it's $54,760. And I heard in the news today that they said the average price of a new vehicle was $33,000. So this might be a stretch for some family budgets, which is a shame because it would make a great family vehicle.
Is it blue?
It is blue. Denim.
Then
blue
I have
denim,
it parked right behind me in the parking lot.
Blue
Greg.
Denim, yeah, blue denim.
Greg?
This week I am
Greg.
I'm awake. I just didn't hit the right switch. This week I am driving a Honda Civic, the coupe, the two-door coupe version. And unlike the sedan, this has got a 2-liter engine under the hood with a 6-speed manual transmission. It's a basic car. You know, you don't have a lot of bells and whistles on it like navigation or satellite radio. However, I was quite pleased with the fact that my cell phone connected to it and I was able to enjoy Pandora yesterday. Took it up into the North Georgia mountains toward Helen and Blairsville and averaged about 33 miles to the gallon. Very nice interior. It's like almost like canvas seats. Retail price,
$19,474. Wow, Frank.
So, good job.
Go ahead, Greg.
I drove that. Just want to say, I drove that too, Greg, and I was very impressed with that.
Oh. Frank.
Hey.
Hey.
I was asleep.
That's okay. We know how to wake you.
Thank you so much. Anyway, what do I have? I just got out of a Lexus 200. What is it? It's a 200 CTH, or is it a Lexus CT? I have to read it.
CT 200H.
Yeah. And basically, you know, I think Lexus has a lot of trouble with this car. It's a hybrid, first of all. Secondly, it has a small engine, 1.8 liter. It has a CVT, and as we all know, the best automaker out there at quieting down the CVT is Nissan. So the CVT is a little bit loud, and that sets up, how should you say, some brand confusion, because Lexus is the Lexus hallmark is quiet. And under hard acceleration, this car is not quiet. It functions well as a hybrid. As most hybrids go, you know, unless you're talking about a Ferrari or a Porsche, they're just so-so in terms of acceleration, or at least they seem like they're so-so in terms of acceleration because of the CVT. You know, and the other thing about it is that for whatever reasons, Lexus has not sold that many of these vehicles. I think when I looked up sales, I think they haven't sold 1,000 of these this year. And so that prompted the question of, has the car or will the car be discontinued? And so I called them and asked, or at least I emailed them and asked. They said no, that it had not been, discontinued. That indeed there will be a 2017 model. In fact, it goes on sale sometime this summer. So as you know, I just don't know about the car, you know, because as I say, the other thing about it is that it the base price is $31,000, which seems ridiculously low for a Lexus. You know, it's kind of one of these things. If it's a real Lexus, it should cost more. You know, that's that sort of thing. I think with options, you know, because of course, as with most hybrids, it's loaded up. So, but even loaded up is $39,435. So, like as I say, you know, as a hybrid, it functions well. You know, it functions like you would expect a small cylinder hybrid to function. You know, but as a Lexus, I'm not sure. The biggest problem may be what we call the Python effect, because basically. Lexus, and the other thing is the styling. You know, it basically looks like a cube. It is a cube. It's somewhat of a square box. And its big thing, the big thing might be is the competition, not from other luxury automakers who have hybrids, but from Lexus itself. Because just about every Lexus, except for the IS, I believe, comes in a hybrid. So if you want a Lexus hybrid, you can buy something that looks like a Lexus. You know, this does not look like a Lexus except for from the front when you look at the spindle grille. So I'm just not sure about the car. As I say, it functions well as a hybrid, but I just don't know about the future of the car. Is it doing what Lexus wanted it to do, and that was bring in younger buyers? When you've got a car like the IS, it seems like the IS does that. So I'm not sure about the future of this car, but it functions well.
Great.
Is the show over?
Yeah, let's go. I
hope not. We didn't let Chris say anything.
All right. Well, this week I'm in a 2016 Volkswagen e-Golf SE. And for those of you who don't know, that is one of their fully electric vehicles. So far, so good, actually. My thoughts on electric vehicles are that they need to be able to fit into your lifestyle. And unfortunately, I do a lot of driving, and so I had to figure out how to make, anytime I get an electric vehicle, I had to figure out how to make it fit into my lifestyle. Now that I'm catching on, I've actually been enjoying the electric vehicles that I get, but it took a bit to actually get to that point. And so, this vehicle here, I mean, it looks just like the Golfs do. There's very little to differentiate it from the other, from the standard gas engine Golf. You've got some e-Golf badging on it. The wheels, they look a little bit different. They're more of the flat style for efficiency and stuff. Besides that, the vehicle looks pretty similar, and the daytime running lights are a little different as well. Personally, I actually like the design of it, and it actually drives pretty decent as well. It's got that typical Golf type of personality when you're driving it. I guess the main difference is that those high efficiency tires tend to protest a little bit earlier than regular tires do. But besides that, it's a pretty decent vehicle.
Great. I call that driver interference when you have to spend so much time trying to figure out how to fit a car or a piece of equipment on a car into what you are, what you're trying to do. It should be so inconspicuous, as I say. But anyway, we do, Chris, I didn't mention this to you before, we do a First Thoughts My Car of the Week. We have it as a first thoughts car. And this is the, can everybody see that? This is the 2016 Jaguar XJR. Remember last week, Russ, we were talking about Jaguars getting one? Well, I had one. It's a 5-liter delivering 550 horsepower, Linda, 550 horsepower with a V8 that's supercharged, made it to an 8-speed automatic transmission. The exterior color is a glacier white. Interior is a jet with red zones, beautiful interior once you get to that. 15 miles per gallon city, 23 highway, 18 combined. And Russ, you can get a couple of these. It's $121,208. Carry that beer yours. You can have one for beer and one for you. This car was just unbelievable to drive. For $121,000, you would say it should be. And it was. It met all of my expectations in terms of luxury and comfort. I love the design. I had a lot of people to look at this thing, and the first question everybody was asking, well, is it reliable? I have to say Jags are now in the reliable category. For those who were thinking 15, 20 years ago, yes, this car is reliable. A couple of things that I found interesting that was missing on this car, and one was it had no adaptive cruise, and I was surprised it didn't have Wi-Fi. And if you look at the Lexus, once it gets to the front, the dashboard, it has a nice series of gauges, but they are digital gauges. I've never liked digital gauges in the Jag. I'm sure there may be a switch or something where you can change the look, but I didn't have time to go and try and figure that out. I prefer the analog look. First thoughts, Valerie.
Oh, I'm thinking you couldn't wipe the smile off your face while you were driving this car, I'm imagining. Of course, it's gorgeous. The Jaguar is another one of my favorite as far as luxury or premium brands. It is very beautiful, but I agree with you. For that sticker, you really don't want to find anything lacking, certainly regarding technology or any extra features, and that does sometimes happen with the Jaguar. So it's gorgeous for folks that can drop, afford a six-figure vehicle. I mean, this would probably be on my list. So you're lucky. Lucky you. It's a beautiful car.
Russ.
Well, this obviously is as close as I'm ever going to get to this car is here on the screen. 7 out of 10 cars that you get, Roosevelt, wind up in my driveway. You had this last week. Did you hear me say I've got the Titan pickup this week? Yeah, it didn't make it to my house. Having said that, what can you say? It's a gorgeous car. I have to agree with you. I'm a little surprised about the not having adaptive cruise control. For $121,000, everything that you want ought to be there. But in terms of styling, in terms of looks, in terms of even heritage, this is a tough car to beat. It's just, it's one of those aspirational cars that everybody pretty much sees coming and goes, man, if only I had $120,000 to spend on wheels. But I think it's a Jaguar.
Ron.
Jaguar just keeps hitting home runs. This car is fabulous, and you look at the two new vehicles that they just introduced. Again, another couple of home runs there. But this car, it's $125,000, but it runs right up there with the big dogs and has everything in it that you need except for some of you folks like that adaptive cruise control. This thing will Autobahn you crazy because it has a top speed. I don't remember what it is, but you can run all day on the Autobahn in Europe if that's what you choose to do. A little overpowered for here, perhaps, but that's what people want. Luxury, as you said, Roosevelt, perfect. Very comfortable. It's got a suspension system that will handle the twisties, up into the Blue Ridge Mountains you guys have back there. Yet it will not punish your passengers and yourself. I think this is a fabulous car.
Linda, first thoughts?
Well, first off, it's gorgeous. And second off, like Russ, I'm sure this is as close as I'm ever going to get to it. I do hope you gave Ree Hartwell my email address.
Yeah, I did.
Okay. I love the lipstick red interior. It really sets it off. And lots of car companies do red interiors, but Jaguar obviously knew how to do it right because that's a beautiful red. Did I see correctly? Is that a stylized Space Saver spare in the trunk of this vehicle?
That's what it looks like. Yep.
I think that's the first of those I've ever seen, which I guess if you look as good as this car does, you don't want to look bad when you have to have a Space Saver spare.
Nope.
Doesn't hurt my feelings at all, but it doesn't have adaptive cruise control because we all know I'm a Neanderthal, so I never use cruise control. I like to actually drive the car myself. 550 horsepower, yeah, Ron's right. That's more power than you need on any of the roads in North Carolina, that's for sure. But it is lovely, and if I win the lottery, guys, I promise I'll buy all of us one of these cars.
Ooh, Greg, first thought.
I just want to know, did you retire from the British Secret Service to get this car? It's absolutely gorgeous. And, the power component of it is just spot on. Jaguar, we know, has always had good drivetrains. They've reached the point where their level of luxury is matching their technology as far as performance. Should it have adaptive cruise control, that would be nice. But if I'm driving this, I don't care. I'm going to run up your backside and run around you like a madman with this. 550 horsepower. Listen, I know a little road up in North Georgia, very few cops. Let's see if we can borrow it and take it up there.
Frank, first thoughts.
I like the car. Basically, when I say that, what I mean is I have not been in the XJR, but I have been in the XJ. And so what we're talking about is a car with a bigger engine or a more powerful engine. I think it's an excellent first effort. And by that, by that, what I mean is I think this is actually Jaguar's first step out of the box into full-size luxury cars, and it's a wonderful effort. I think the car, in terms of the car I had, it was smooth, it was quiet, it did all those things you expect of a $100,000-plus car. Personally, I would like to see more wood and less plastic in the car, at least in the car that I had. There was a lot of, what do they call it, piano black, which is basically plastic. And I'd like to see less of that and more wood. Again, I agree with you. I do not like that TFT screen. I would rather see some real instruments. You know, at that price, how should you say, it shouldn't be a matter of money using real instruments. And at least if you're going to use a TFT screen, at least do something creative. And I have yet to see anybody. I haven't been in the new Mercedes-Benz S-Class. But to date, I have yet to see anybody do something creative with this TFT screen. It seems like somewhere somebody made up a template and said, here. And every automaker takes it and basically maybe change a color here, change a color there. But I can't wait to see the second generation of this car, because that's probably why it doesn't have adaptive cruise control. Because no matter how slick it looks here, and it is a slick car, basically, it's the first generation electronics that you're dealing with. And as we all know, electronics move at warp speed, and they got caught, with regular cruise control. So I would fully expect to see adaptive cruise control and who knows what else on the second generation of this car, which should be coming in maybe a couple of years.
Great. That's carbon fiber, Frank, not wood. First thoughts, Chris.
I think it's a beautiful car. With regards to the adaptive cruise control everybody's been talking about, I've seen it happen where they omit it on cars, like when that new Maserati Ghibli had come out, you couldn't get it on that. But at least with those, they're more boutique-ish type car companies. With Jaguar, I don't know. I think that is kind of a notable omission, especially people buying $100,000 cars from Jaguar. They'd expect that type of technology in them. I don't need it, but I do see where that could be an issue. I actually kind of like the display, the dashboard. I appreciate that instrument panel. I like being able to change stuff and put different stuff up on the screen that I want to see, whether it's music or navigation or what have you. I don't know exactly how much customization. Thank you. I don't know how much customization there is in that car, but a lot of times you can change some of the features that are shown on that screen, and so that's something that I've always appreciated. But overall, I mean, I think the car is pretty nice, and I'd love to take one for a spin.
Well, that's a spin there. I wish you could hear the audio. But anyway, that's the first thoughts car, and that's what I had this week. As a matter of fact, it's still sitting out there waiting for them to pick it up. It'll be tomorrow morning. Okay, moving right along. In the news, boy, with all these people on here, the show's almost over. It's moving. In the news, recalls. Toyota's recalls something like 3.37 million cars worldwide, and it's a combination of things, combination of product, but I think a lot of it is a lot of the cars are the Prius. Has to do with the emissions control unit. It's prone to crack, which may actually cause a fuel leak, and that's not a good thing. That's on the 2016 through the 2006 rather through 2015 models. Ford also had a recall. They recalled something like 900 2015 to 2016 to Focus electric vehicles, and you need to take it in and get installed a new transmission differential. It could wear out. and that's not a good thing. They also are recalling 7,000 2016 F-150s and the Explorer. The driver's seat may not be welded properly, and obviously if you have an accident, well, it may not be a bad thing, because the next thing we're getting into is the car to airbag situation. So if that seat hits you and the well's in good, the seat may knock you back and you won't take the full brunt of the blow from the car to airbag. And we were in the green room, and this is major, the next recall here. And I think Russ and I were talking about it. Honda has put out, well, the U.S. government, rather, has asked Honda to put out a stop driving notice for over 313,000 cars, because 50% of the 2001 through 2003 models, the Takata airbag and inflators may explode in an accident. Now, for them to put out a stop driving notice, that's a big problem. And like Russ was saying, he was asking, what does the person do if you can't drive the car? Comments, folks, what do you think? This inflator situation with Takata is just gotten out of hand.
I think I think a lot of people are going to continue to drive that car. And the question becomes, how many of them bring it in to get fixed? Because, I mean, let's face it, if you're talking about a car 2003, 2004, you're basically talking about people who need their car, and this is not a second car, they need this car, and I think they would be hard pressed to park it, and so therefore you may have more people suffering shrapnel injuries because of the car. But I don't think you're going to see a lot of people pulling over in this car, because there's not an alternative to driving.
Right. Good point. Right.
I have a friend that has a Honda Element. Not sure what year it is, but he's had it for 10 years or so at least. So I'm assuming it may be in this group here. And he lives on the panhandle of Florida. And he has taken his Element in and had the airbags replaced. But they replaced the one that's in the steering column, but they did not replace anything in the air curtain on the side, and he's very nervous about this. And then he found out that they replaced it with another Takata airbag. So he is, it's luckily he has another vehicle, but he's scared to death to drive the vehicle. This is just a really bad deal. And is there nobody else on the planet that makes airbags but Takata? I mean, and why do manufacturers? Why do they take out one Takata airbag and put in another Takata airbag? I'm perplexed by that.
Well, I think there are a couple of other manufacturers, and I can't remember the name. I think when we did this story, maybe last year, I had the names of the manufacturers. And it was interesting enough that the replacement manufacturer they were going to use had a similar issue. And you're right, Linda, when they replaced, even with the replacement of some of the Takata airbags late last year, they were put in after they were supposedly been tested, and they were having the same problem. So this whole situation is not getting better. It's getting worse. I think the last count that we looked at was somewhere over 60 million cars out there with the Takata bags and the inflators that may go off at any time. So you're sitting behind a time bomb. And we're trying to get people to really understand you can die sitting in your car at a traffic light if this airbag goes off. Nobody has to hit you. The airbag in front of you could go off and explode and send shrapnel all throughout your body, which it has done with several people, around the world, and quite a few people, well, several people here even in the United States. And we talk about recalls practically every week, regardless of what the recall is, whether you think it's inconsequential or not. Take your car in and get the doggone thing repaired. It makes no sense to take that kind of risk in cars today, not just Takata airbags, but all the other issues that these cars have. And I can attribute a lot of this to this sales situation that's going on now. Everybody's talking about record sales, record sales, record sales. And we're also having record recalls, and record recalls on top of all of that. And the dealers, they're taking people out of cars that come in for recalls and putting them in new cars, but they're also putting them in new cars that some of them already have recall problems.
Did you hear about Toyota this week?
Yeah, go ahead.
Toyota announced another 1.4 million cars being recalled for airbag issues, and they won't say if it's Takata or not, but it's like it keeps going and going and going. And Russ has pointed this out, and so has Ron. I think Linda's pointed out that after a while, it's going to be darn near every car built probably since 2008 forward is going to have this issue. And the big part of it is the industry is shrunken in a way where you used to have multiple vendors that could provide these services. It's one or two companies that everybody's using. It may be time to expand it out and bring in somebody else who actually builds a safe airbag. And you really want to look at what is the accepted technology for safety in these devices. I'm going to show my age, but I remember doing a story on the first airbags that they put in Plymouth vehicles for police departments back in New Jersey years ago. And they had the state police commandant sit in the vehicle, the airbag deployed and hit him in the face. And the first words out of his mouth says, "My God, if there's shrapnel or any metal in here, I'm dead." This is no secret. This has been going on for a while, folks.
Most people don't realize that you cannot send an airbag through the mail. And the reason you can't send an airbag through the mail, it is technically a bomb. So the U.S. Postal System will not let you mail an airbag. You have to send it by some other means.
Even if you put it in a plain brown paper wrapper?
Well, I guess
with duct tape?
They expect you to be honest there, Russ.
You've been to Mendocino County, haven't you?
Hey, Greg, the good news is the value of your Volvo, your vintage Volvo, just went up.
I was
so happy when I went online to check to see if my 2002 Mini Cooper had an airbag recall to find out it's not on the list. So I feel safe in my 2002 Mini Cooper.
You know, we laugh about some of this stuff. And recalls, like I said earlier, is some serious business. And I think that not just the manufacturers, I really think that the car companies, when they're doing their advertising, they should have some little blurb in there telling people to check your car for a recall. I think it would bode well for them in the long run to be transparent and upfront with potential customers.
Well, Roosevelt, you and I both have worked for dealerships, and I've worked for the manufacturers. Number one marketing, and it costs nothing for the dealer. It's a marketing treasure trove here to get people in your dealerships. I'd be knocking at the door getting these people in just so that I could see if I could either sell them a new car, some new service, or just give them a little PR and
right.
Tell them how wonderful you are. I can't believe the dealers are just kind of falling back on it and not doing much either. So,
you know, they're doing something, but not enough. Frank.
I think it's kind of one of these things where, from their perspective, as well as dealers and automakers as well, in my view, it's basically good business not to say anything. Because, you know, if I'm making the product, the last thing I want to do is tell the public to come in and get it fixed. You know, you're just working at cross purposes there. Even though it's not anything wrong with the overall product. In other words, it's not Ford, it's Takata, you know. But that gets you into an area that, you know, you just don't have time to get into. And I think one of the reasons why we don't see a lot of deals, and particularly car makers, automakers themselves, advertising, you know, that people come in, is because, you know, basically you're saying, come on in because there's something wrong with the car we sold you. You know, it's like, wait a minute. I don't see them doing that unless forced or unless basically there's some litigation, you know, somewhere. Somebody basically wins a suit, you know, saying that they should have known or they should have advertised better or they should have alerted their product. You know, there has to be incentive. And right now there's no, I don't see any way that there's an incentive because, you know, we're living in an era where long range doesn't count. There's no long range anything. You know, I don't care what it is, whether it's money, whether it's the stock market, whether it's politics, you know, it just doesn't count. Nobody really does long range planning or thinking anymore, at least not, you know, out here where we can see it.
I agree with you up to a point, Frank, but I really think that since this issue with the Carter, I think the attitude of the dealer and the manufacturer has to change because now you're dealing with something, a situation that can literally kill somebody. It may be called the Carter, but the customer only sees Ford, Chevy, Honda, Toyota.
Exactly.
And that's all they see.
Exactly. That's my point.
Yeah, I know that's your point, but what I'm saying is if you're driving one of these cars and you check the VIN number, which you can go online and do that, and your car is in for a recall, dealers should be calling those customers. They're calling them anyway trying to sell them a car. I think for the first time, this is a positive situation that they can call a customer and try and save them some time, some money, and possibly their life, but not just for the airbag situation, but for all the other recalls. We talk all the time about how complicated a car is. There are going to be mistakes. There are going to be situations where you're going to have to take the car in for a repair. And I think now the attitude of consumers have changed in terms of wanting transparency, and those companies that provide the transparency are the ones that the company, the ones that the consumers are going to start doing more business with. Another example, 2014-2015 Jeep Grand Cherokee, where the gear shift control supposedly moved into neutral and killed this actor. Got a lot of press. Another situation where a person was killed. Cars now are killing people not by having accidents out on the highway, they're killing them in your yards. Like I said before, they're killing you sitting at a stoplight. So transparency to me is critical now from car companies and auto dealers, and they should let, they're going to call the customer, try to sell them something. They should call them, get them in there, repair the situation, yeah, and then try and sell them another car. I don't have a problem with them trying to sell somebody another car. But I do have a problem with them not letting people know that their particular car may have or has a problem.
They could call them Takata-free cars.
Go ahead, Chris.
I was just saying they could call them Takata-free cars.
What's the free?
Takata-free. They don't have a Takata airbag.
Well, that's going to be hard.
But, you know, I think that with some consumers, that when they hear, oh, bring your car in, we need to look at this, the first thing that comes into their mind is, oh, there's nothing really wrong with my car. They just want to sell me a car. And so they don't bring it in because they don't think it's a legitimate concern because they haven't experienced anything that seems out of the ordinary. Now, we all know that it's a very, very serious situation. But, you know, when you were saying, just look at your VIN number, I would challenge you to go out and find 10 people on the street and ask them if they know what their VIN number is on their car. Most of them probably wouldn't have a clue, even where to look for it.
Yeah, but I mean, if I had, but if I'm a salesperson and I call you from a dealership, I'm going to take the position that, no, you don't know what a VIN number is. I'm going to take the position that you don't even know how to check your VIN number. So I'm going to have you on the phone and I'm going to walk you through it. While you're on the phone, I can say, hey, put me on hold, go out to your car, look here, 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 and here, and take a piece of paper or take your phone, like we were talking about earlier, where you can now take a picture. Go out and jot it down, take a picture, come back here. Now, sit in front of your computer, go to this website, plug this number in, and you'll know whether your car's on there. What does that take, 5-10 minutes maybe?
Yeah, but well, part of it is also, and I've seen this with people I've known who've had cars that have gotten recall notices. And they'll say, I don't want to take the time. It takes so long to go to the dealership. I'm tied up all day while they got my car. And I look at them and say, okay, what's more important? Losing an afternoon or a morning at the dealership while they check your car for a recall issue, or possibly losing your life?
Well, you know, that's part of the problem, you know, in the sense that, you know, a lot of people said, well, maybe that's happening, but it's not going to happen to me.
Yeah.
You know, unless it, it's happening, but it hasn't happened to me. It's not going to happen to anybody I know. This sort of thing. There has to be some incentive, and as yet, you know, other than it's the right thing to do. You know, we're not living in a society where it's the right thing to do rules. You know, it's there has to be some incentive. It, you know, the incentive of if I don't do this, if I'm a dealer or an automaker, if I don't do this, then I expose myself to potential litigation. You know, it's got to be something on that order to make manufacturers do this. And then the other thing is it's a pain in the rear because, you know, you say, well, I'll make them call. Well, when do you call them? You know, most people are gone during the day. So you know, you have to basically, you know, what's the cost of this? Because people are going to have to make these calls. A lot of these calls are going to have to be made in the evening, you know, when people are at home. You know, their car is parked and they have time to do this. So I'm not saying don't do it. But what I'm saying is there has to be some incentive to force the industry, because it's got to be the industry in terms of the dealers and the manufacturers to do this. Because heretofore, what they would do is say, well, this is under recall. You know, you put it out there in terms of the VIN number, so on and so forth, and it's up to and it's up to the consumer to know, you know, that the car is under recall. This should be done and that should be done. Because as you were mentioning, this goes beyond Takata, because with the Jeeps, there were, I think, it was almost 1 million of them. You know, I think it was the number I saw was something
1.1 million worldwide.
Yeah. You know, we're under recall, and how many of them have been brought back, you know, by consumers to get the this thing fixed? Because basically, what happened to the actor was really a freak accident. You know, however, you've got a car that's in the, you know, that you think's in park, and it can literally drive off.
Now, it's interesting, when I heard that, and we've all played with these new gear shifters. As a matter of fact, the Jaguar has one of those gear shifters in it. And I turned the Jag off. It was still in drive. It automatically shifted to park. I wanted to see if it would change, and it did. It automatically shifted to park.
Well, that's the issue with the Grand Cherokee and the Chargers and the Chrysler 300s that were part of that shifter recall, is that I guess if the engine's running and the car is not in park and you open the driver's door, there are some things that chime and there is an alert or something. But if it doesn't, you know, if you're in a hurry, you're not thinking, and you can do this with a traditional automatic transmission as well. You're thinking about something, you're yelling at the kids or whatever, and you pull up and you think you forgot you haven't actually shifted into park, and it's easy to hop out and have an issue. With this shift lever, it's that kind of rocker shifter that you push it and it engages a gear and then it snaps back to a mid position. And unless you actually physically, this Audi I just had the very same kind of shifter. And if you don't look at the gear shift indicator on the gauge package, I mean, you've got to double check it, because you can't, there's just no way of knowing for sure. And unfortunately, Jeep or Fiat Chrysler in this, they've recalled 13,000 Maseratis too in the last week for the very same thing. If you don't, they don't. Their system doesn't automatically shift into park for you if you don't do it. Most Audis do. Most Mercedes that have these shifters do. Most BMWs do. If you open that door, or you turn the ignition off and it's not in park, it will automatically shift it into park for you. What happened with this Anton Yelchin, this actor who was killed, is he apparently thought he was in park and wasn't in park and got out of his vehicle and walked behind it and it started rolling back. He didn't see it and got squished. But that's what that recall issue is about.
Right, Valerie.
Roosevelt, yeah, well, I have a segue for us. While we were talking, I've been Googling, and I did find a page that showed about 12 brands that have Takata recalls going on, but I noticed that General Motors was missing, so I looked into that, and they have been part of it as well, it turns out, on their trucks and SUVs, but they're fighting it. They've done a preliminary, but they're not really sure yet if it's going to be required because they have had no incidents among 44,000 deployments of their airbags so far. They haven't had any other incidents related to Takata, so they're kind of hesitant about going full throttle on their recalls, but that's another segue to this class action lawsuit. I don't know if you want to talk about that.
Go ahead.
On the Cruise diesel, where folks are saying that it was marketed and sold as a clean air vehicle, it turns out, and it wasn't not so much, and so that there may be the same kind of shenanigans on the Cruise diesel that Volkswagen was facing, where there were some fixes put in to make it seem cleaner, but it really wasn't. So I don't know if, so it seems like General Motors is still going to be on that roller coaster of having to put out some fires here.
And you saw where Volkswagen settled this week.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yes, yeah, I did.
If I can make a couple of comments about the transmission situation. Okay, number one, Fiat Chrysler made a video to show people how to use the transmission. To me, that blatantly says, this is not the best design in the world if we have to give you a video on how to change gears on your transmission.
Okay, driver distraction.
We keep talking about it engaging a gear. It is my understanding that, you know, when I think about engaging a gear, I think about a fork that goes into a ring set that's actually physically engaging a gear. This is a computer control stick. That's all it is. There's no detent that goes on because there's no physical activity. It's the same thing as pushing a button on that touch screen. So there's no real sensation to let the driver know, okay, this is why it is, because people ask me all the time, they say, why do they build transmissions like that? Because everything in a car now is controlled by a computer, and it's a lot cheaper to do it this way than to try to make it seem like it used to be when there were actually mechanical moving parts that were physically engaged. So, you know, it's like, if you got to do a video, it's just a real, really, you know, I'm sure there's some litigant somewhere that's just going to take them to church over this. I mean, it's like you put a product out there and the general public can't use it without watching a video on knowing how to use it, and it's the basic function of the automobile. You know, I just had a Lincoln MKX, and my husband had to drive me home from a procedure at the hospital, and he actually had to get out the manual to figure out where the gear shift was, because it's a series of buttons that run down the side of the touchscreen. Now, granted, my husband is a self-admitted Neanderthal, but it was so frustrating to him. There were two stalks there. One, I think, was for the windshield wipers, and the other was for the turn signal, and he thought, well, maybe I have to talk to it. Some of these cars you have to talk to. And finally, in desperation, he got out the manual so he could get back to the front door to pick me up. You know, when you're spending the kind of money that people spend for cars now, I don't think they should be this complicated when what their original goal was to try to make it simpler, but they really haven't made it simpler. They've made it more complicated and created, as you said, Roosevelt, driver distractions, things that, you know, drivers don't anticipate and don't expect.
Well, moving right along, we have one or two more topics. We're at about a minute to go. The cheapest convertible in the market right now is the 2017 Smart for Two Cabrio, $19,650. And that's made by Mercedes. So you can get a Mercedes, folks, for $19,650.
If you're crazy.
Okay. There are a lot of crazy people out there, Greg.
Not that crazy.
Here we go. We're at the 4 o'clock hour. Chris, I want to thank you for joining us. Hopefully we will see you next Thursday. If you make it next Thursday, you will only be the first person that has done that with us. Anyway, thank you. I appreciate you taking the time in to join us. I look forward to you participating more. If you have some topics that you want to bring up, feel free to jump right in and bring them up. But as usual, folks, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. Buckle up. Don't text and drive. Buckle up. Check your VIN number for recalls. And we'll see you next Thursday, 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Bye.
Happy 4th of July, folks. Everybody's
going to be so happy. Thank you. Bye-bye.